Today, we're gonna do the classic FizzBuzz question. And after solving the problem, I'll talk a little bit about its history, which is pretty interesting because it says a lot about how interviews have evolved since 2007 when the question was invented. And I'll also leave you with my own twist on the problem so that you can get practice thinking about a whole new problem you've never seen before. So watch out for that. And I think this is the big idea behind the FizzBuzz story. Technical interviews at their best are all about seeing how you handle problems you've never seen before. So I'll start by reading the question, and this version is slightly different from the original, and I really wish they would make a note of that, but I'll make sure to show you the original question later in the video. So given an integer n, return a string array answer that's one indexed, where answer I is FizzBuzz if I is divisible by 3 and 5, answer I is Fizz if I is divisible by 3, it's Buzz if I is divisible by 5, and it's I as a string if none of the above conditions are true. So they're telling us what should happen with the ith element in our result array answer, but I don't really understand how to think about this one indexed thing. So my first question is, what exactly does one indexed mean here? Let's see if the examples will give us more insight. From example one, I can see that n is the number of elements in the result array, and I'm also starting to see what they mean by one indexed. They don't mean literally that the first element should start at index one. What they actually mean is this. So this is just example one in table form. We have the actual array index, we have fake I, which is I as it's defined in the problem, and I named it fake I so we don't confuse it with the actual array index. And then finally, we have the element value. And once we have this laid out in table form, we can see that fake I is just one more than the actual index. So we figured out the one index thing, but we still need to think more carefully about the relationship between fake I and the element value. So we have the set of numbers that are evenly divisible by 3, and then we have the set of numbers that are evenly divisible by 5. And of course, we also have the set that's evenly divisible by both, represented by the intersection, and I'll add a label right here for both. And then finally, we have the set of numbers that are not divisible by 3 or by 5, and that's everything outside of the circles, and I'll label that neither. And this accounts for all the situations. So Fizz is just the left side without the intersection, Buzz is just the right side without the intersection, and FizzBuzz is the intersection. So let's translate this diagram into formal logic that's a little bit closer to code. So in the Fizz case, we want just the left side, excluding the intersection. So I'll start off with if divisible by 3, but if we only check for divisibility by 3, we'll get the entire left circle with the intersection, which isn't what we want. So to get the blue part just by itself, we'll also have to make sure that the number is not divisible by 5. So if it's divisible by 3, and not 5. The Buzz case is really similar. First, we're gonna get the entire right circle if we check for divisibility by 5. So we'll start off with that. If divisible by 5, this will give us the entire right circle with the intersection. So to exclude the intersection, we have to add and not 3. And then checking for the intersection only is pretty simple. We just check for if it's divisible by 3 and 5, then that will give us just the intersection. And then for all other cases, I'll just add an else. And then finally, I'll connect these with else if because we want these to be mutually exclusive. So this will be if, this will be an else if, and so will this. And I really like this logic because it's extremely explicit about what it's doing, and it represents exactly what's happening in our Venn diagram. A lot of people will have the temptation to shorten these expressions though, and this is where things can get dangerous. So I'm gonna copy and paste and show you what I mean below. So the urge is to take a look at this expression and get rid of that, and then in this line, get rid of this part, and then it feels so much neater, right? But the problem is that everything that's divisible by 3 and 5 is also divisible by 3. And so if you have this check first, it will be impossible to ever fall into this case. And so this is actually logically equivalent to not having line 10 at all. It's as if you just deleted the FizzBuzz case entirely. Now, to relate this to the Venn diagram, this logic fails to distinguish between the blue and the dark green in the middle. Now, to fix this, we can reorder things so that we fully check for the intersection first. Doing this has the effect of carving out the intersection completely so that there's no chance of lumping it together with one of the other cases later. And so if I cut this and then move it to the top, and then all we have to do is change this to an if, and then this becomes an else if. And so there's an interesting trade-off here. If you remove the explicit checks that we had before, you end up replacing them with implicit checks that are harder to notice, because now there's logic that's hidden in the ordering of the expressions. Now that we've carefully worked out the core logic, let's move on to implementation, and I'll show you both approaches, starting with the explicit one. So first, I want to create our result, so it will just be an empty array, and now I want to work out the iteration. So we want the indices in the array to go from 0 to n minus 1. So for array index in range, n will give us that. And then I want to work out the fake I. So it's just the array index plus 1. So fake I is the array index plus 1. And then all we have to do is we need to translate this block into code. So let me indent and work out each line. So first, we want to see if fake I is divisible by 3. So if fake I modulo 3 is 0, and it's not divisible by 5. So fake I modulo 5 is not equal to 0. Then we add fizz. So result.append fizz. This case is really similar. Else if fake I is divisible by 5, and not divisible by 3. So fake I modulo 3 is not equal to 0. This is the buzz case, so result.append buzz. And then finally, well, not finally, but second to last, we have divisible by both 3 and 5. Then we add fizz buzz. And then else, we add fake I as a string. So result.append string fake I. And then the last step is just to return our result. So return result, and then we can submit. And then really quickly, I'll show you how to do the implicit version right here. So it's just a few modifications. First, we want this to be at the top. So I moved it up. Then we get some space, and then let me get rid of this space right here. And then this turns into an if, this turns into an elif, and then we just need to modify the logic here. We just need to remove the and portions. So get rid of this, and then update the comment to match. Same thing here, get rid of this, and then update the comment to match, and this should work perfectly fine too. The performance for both approaches is the same, so it will take O of n time because of this loop, and then for space, it depends on how you define it. So if you include the result array, then it would be O of n space, but since creating this result is unavoidable, you could also say that this takes O of 1 space when you exclude the output. So either is fine as long as you clearly state your assumptions. So that's LeetCode's version of FizzBuzz. Now let's look at the original post about the question from Imran Ghori, who authored it in the first place. His original post about the problem is no longer available, but I was able to find it on the Internet Archive. So I'll take you through a few key points. On occasion, you meet a developer who seems like a solid programmer. But once it comes down to actually producing code, they just don't seem to be able to do it well. After a fair bit of trial and error, I've come to discover that people who struggle to code don't just struggle on big problems or even smallish problems. They struggle with tiny problems. So I set out to develop questions that can identify this kind of developer and came up with a class of questions I call FizzBuzz questions. So Imran's point isn't really about this question. It's about an entire class of tiny questions that can identify people that can't really program. And then he poses the original question, and this is so much better than LeetCode's version. It doesn't have the pointless distractions like the one index thing. But the main thing that makes this better is that Imran introduces the constraints in a way that preserves the challenge of the problem. On LeetCode, if you take the implicit approach and just blindly write out your code following the question, it will work because you'll check for the intersection first. And so a lot of people will get it right by accident, which completely destroys the filtering power of the question. You won't get any signal out of asking the question the way it's written on LeetCode. Most good programmers should be able to write out on paper a program which does this in under a couple of minutes. The majority of computer science graduates can't. I've also seen self-proclaimed senior programmers take more than 10 to 15 minutes to write a solution. I'm not saying these people can't write good code, but to do so, they'll take a lot longer to ship it. This sort of question won't identify great programmers, but it will identify the weak ones. So when I read this post for the first time in 2012, I was really resistant and couldn't believe it. But through my work in the last 12 years, I've interviewed hundreds of people, and I've seen it up close over and over again from people with years of experience and computer science degrees. And that's why people still ask easy questions like this. When done well, they really do filter out a ton of people that look qualified on paper. I think a lot of interviewers take away the wrong lesson though. They literally ask FizzBuzz, expecting to get the same result as Imran did before the problem was popular. And you could replace FizzBuzz with any popular question today. But it's obviously not gonna work if people have already specifically prepared for that question. So you have to come up with your own problems or at least add a novel twist. So as promised, I'll leave you with mine. The goal is exactly the same as the original right on the screen. The only difference is that you can't use the modulo operator, and you should limit yourself to language features and concepts that a total beginner would know. So really strive to do it as simply as possible, as there are simpler and more complicated approaches.